I don't speak Italian at all, sorry for that. So I will talk to you in French about the ethology of cattle. First, you all know that cattle has been domesticated about 8,500 years ago, and in the first place it was used for meat, work and milk. Before the 19th century, the different genotypes were selected to cope with climate conditions, and the actual breeds we all know now have been starting to be selected more or less in the 19th century. So this leads to new phenotypes with changes in physiology, anatomy, but to a lesser extent in behavior. Today we have a specialized breeds either for meat or milk, and also dual proposed breeds. So my talk today, we will talk about different aspects of cattle behavior. First, the sensory abilities, then cognitive abilities, then in the third part about social behavior and human-animal relationships. In the fourth part, we'll be talking about biological rhythm and the use of space. And finally, the fifth part will be a very tiny part, because Christoph Winkler will be talking about welfare assessment afterwards, but it's like a transition. So, the sensory abilities of cattle. As you all know, cattle use five senses, which are totally different from humans. In cattle, the sight, the vision, is the dominant sight. And as you can see here, So you know that the cattle have their eyes on the lateral part of the head, and this gives them very wide visual field and also very wide monocular vision. That means that cattle have difficulties in estimating distances. Cattle can distinguish between colors. They have good abilities to discriminate between longer related colors like red, yellow, and orange, and between short weather-late colors. But within those types of colors, they have a good discrimination between long wavelength, but lower discrimination between, for instance, blue, gray, and green. Which means that if you want to wear an overhaul to see cattle, you can choose either blue, gray, or green. They don't care. Cattle are also much more sensitive than we are to sudden movements, which means that in your current practice, you have already seen that you have to use very slow movements. For instance, a cattle will see, if I move my arms, you can see my palms like this, but a cattle will see lots of many little arms, and this is very impressive to them. So we have to pay attention with that when we are working with animals. They are also very sensitive to contrasts, and especially contrasts between light and dark. And when you move cattle, and here you can see on the ground that there is a drain, and this is a contrast for the animals, which make them balk and stop. So this will make movement more difficult. So we have to pay attention to all details. These are details for us, but not for the cattle. Science in the 80s tried to have a better knowledge about discrimination in cattle, and what the researcher found is that cattle are able to discriminate between very basic shapes such as triangles, squares, or circles. The researcher also demonstrated that cattle are myopic, and that their perception of details is much lesser good than in humans. They have also little ability to accommodate. They need more time than us to accommodate, and they are not very. They don't have very good brightness discrimination. But one of the other important thing is that they need more time than we do to cope with changing brightness. If we enter a room, for example, today where it's very sunny outside, and if we enter in the room and imagine the room is very dark, in your opinion, how many times do we need humans to get accustomed to the new light? Anyone has an idea?
Seconds?
How many seconds?
2?
10? Okay, around 10. How many seconds for a cow? More? Yeah. Otherwise, I wouldn't have to ask the question. So, 30 seconds? Other ideas in the room? No? Okay. So the answer is we need more or less 30 seconds for a cow. It can take them 3 minutes. Okay. So this means that we really have to pay attention to such detail when we are working with the animals. Another question that we always ask is, can a cow recognize us? And the answer is yes. Cows are able to recognize faces. They can also recognize the color of the coverall, which means that if a vet wear a particular coverall, she will remember the vet. And cows are also able to discriminate people by their age. Now I will present you the other hearing and everything in the cows. And so hearing in the cow is also important because it's involved in communication. The message here is that they can hear a broader hearing. They have a broader hearing range that we have, and they can hear. This means that they can hear sounds that we can't hear. So we have to pay attention to that, and they are very sensitive to shouting. So when we work with cattle, we have to use a calm voice. That's very important. Olfaction. Olfaction is also important for intraspecies communication. Odor is detected in two places in the cow, so in the nasal cavity and in the vomeronasal organ. And cows use pheromones to communicate. Such pheromones convey reproductive information because oestrous pheromones are released from the body surface, but they are also conveying fear. And so there are pheromones present in urine and also in the blood. Now we can talk about tastes in cattle. Basically, two tastes are positive to these animals. Sweet tastes and umami tastes. The bitter taste is, in the first place, there are indifference in the first place to bitter taste, and then it has a negative value for the cattle. Regarding the sour taste, when it has low intensity, it's positive for the animals, but when it's at high intensity, it's more negative. And finally, the salty taste. You know, always farmer tell you that cattle like salt. Actually, according to the research, it depends on the mineral status of the animals. Other important findings in ruminants show that taste develops in utero during pregnancy, and that the maternal diet can affect the dietary preferences of the offspring. The tactile sense. So the cows have many kind of receptors on the skin. They have mechanoreceptors that help them detect movement and force, thermoreceptors that can help them to detect temperature changes, and they have also nociceptors. According to people, there are many sensitive zones on the cow, around the mouth, around the eyes, the ears, and around the tail, but there is no scientific literature about it, so we don't know if we stroke cows on this side, if it's lower the cattle. But I will talk to you about stroking after in that conference. So these sensitive zones can be used during the self and allo grooming of the cows using brushes, for instance, or by conspecific or humans. Cattle, like us humans, have a personal space that is called flight zone, and so it's represented here by a circle around the animal, and which means that if a conspecific or a human or a dog enter that flight zone, it will induce a reaction from the animal. This reaction can be either flight or attack. So you can see here on the picture a woman who is entering the flight zone of the cow, and it makes the cow move forward. And actually the flight zone depends on how tame the animal is, and it's also affected by the type of interaction that the cow has with humans. Now I will present you some results about the cognitive abilities of the cattle. Cognition gathers all the mechanisms by which the animals acquire, process, store, and act on information from the environment. Cognition is important in behavior, and the hypothesis is that the species differ in their cognitive abilities as a result of differing ecological pressure and their evolutionary trajectories. So the study of cognition gathers many fields, like sensory systems that I just presented to you, but also learning and memory, decision making, navigation, communication, and language and reasoning. So I will illustrate you some of them right now. And I will start with learning. Learning can be explained by a few processes. The two main processes are classical conditioning. You know the experiment of Pavlov with the dog and the bell. And in that experiment, so classical conditioning is the association between a novel stimulus, the sound, and an unconditioned stimulus. And there is also the instrumental conditioning, called also operant conditioning, which is the relationship between a stimulus and responses based on the consequences of the behavior, either reward or punishment. So here, if you could please... So this is a video that's available on the internet, and the calf was trained to push with his nose the screen when the color is red, it touches and then it gets food rewards. And he was trained to avoid white screen. So he's hiding. So this is very basic training. Cattle, using instrumental conditioning, we can also train cattle to respond to very basic orders. So this is me with one of the heifer in the vet school. And this heifer was trained for several things, among which to come when I call her. So we can't hear, but I told her come. So she comes. I call her again, and she comes. And in the vet school, we try to train the heifers to do many things, either very stupid or not, but it works well, and we were very astonished at the speed of learning in these animals. Cattle also have special memory, which means that they are able to remember locations. For instance, heifers can quickly learn which side of a tea maize contains cream, and they can also learn that food will not be in a location where they previously visited, even if the visits were separated by 8 hours. But when the intervals increased, the cattle couldn't remember that. And this was tested in radial mazes and in parallel arm mazes. So cattle can communicate. They can communicate, and the visual signals are the main signals they use. This is performed through body and head posture. So this is a very neutral posture. You can see the posture of the neck and of the head. When the cattle are in vigilant or alert states, they raise their head, so the head is up, the ears are forward, and the eyes are wide open. When they explore or they approach, so for instance here there is a dog, you can see that they lower the head and the ears are also put forward. But the lower head doesn't mean only approach, it can also mean aggression. And here you can see that the forehead is more at 90 degrees from the ground. And the ears can be generally oriented backwards. But it depends. It's not like in horses, for instance. The tail is also important for communication, and raised tail is often observed in flight circumstances. And when the cattle is experiencing fear or submission, it will help the tail between the legs. Cattle are also able to feel emotions. To recognize the animals as sentient beings, it's to recognize that they have emotional capacities, and that the cows are attempting to minimize exposure to situations that elicit negative emotions, such as fear, frustration, distress, or anxiety. And on the other side, they can seek situations that elicit positive emotions, such as pleasure and joy. For researchers, a better understanding of the range and depth of emotion that cattle experience is essential in order to safeguard and improve the welfare. And this is a very broad range of the current research, is to better understand cattle emotions. So an emotion, what is it? It's an intense but short-lived affective response to an event, and it's associated with specific body changes. And an emotion is different from sensation and from feeling. Sensation is a physical consequence of exposure to particular stimuli, for instance, heat or pressure. And a feeling is an internal state with no specific references to external reaction. So an emotion can be described by a subjective component, which is the emotional experience. In humans, we can assess this emotional experience through discussing. For instance, I can say, oh, I feel very bad today, which is not the case. And they can be described also by two explicit components, such as behavioral response through, for instance, galloping, or face expression, and also by physiological responses such as heart rate or cortisol secretion. And in research, we assess the emotional experiences of the animal through the behavioral response and through the physiological response. Another important thing is to understand that the emotion arises from the cognitive process that the animal engages to evaluate the event. So when there is an event, it is perceived by the animal, and the animal will evaluate this event. It will evaluate it through certain characteristics, such as suddenness, familiarity, predictability, or presentness. and also based on the consequences of the event, relating, for instance, to its own expectations. And through this evaluation and through the combination of all these criteria, the kind of emotion will arise and will result from the combination of these criteria. And then the animal will react through behavior and physiology. So in our group in France, one of the current research was to test the relevance of these characteristics, these ones, in animals by elaborating experimental situations in which one elementary characteristic was prominent. I will present you results on sheep because it's the model we used, but we can suspect that the same process are present in cattle. So in this experiment, we tested the predictability of an event, and the animals received 10 food deliveries, with 5 of them were followed by a sudden event. And this event was an airflow, which is very negative for the sheep. And this event was either occurred at random or was signaled by a bell. And we recorded the startle and tachycardia in the sheep. And the interesting thing here is to see that when the negative event was performed without signaling to the animal that it was arriving, the animal responded with eye startle and eye tachycardia. When the same event occurred but was signaled to the animal, it provoked less startle and less tachycardia. So this means that the predictability of a sudden event reduces the reaction to suddenness. And if you have ever worked, for instance, with birds, you know that when you enter a building, you always knock at the door to make your entry into the building more predictable by the birds and to avoid flight reactions. So it is the same in ruminants and in sheep and cattle. So now I will present you some information on social behavior and human-animal relationships. So you all know that cattle are social animals. In this experiment, the cows were restrained in a chute, and they were either with conspecific or on their own. And you can see here that when the cattle were isolated from their conspecific, they showed more signs of stress, such as movement, vocalization, cortisol in blood, and increase of heart rate. Cows can recognize each other. They are able to discriminate their own species, so they are able to discriminate a photo of cattle versus other species, such as dogs, horses, sheep, and goats. Cattle are also able to discriminate individuals from photographies, and they can recognize familiar individuals. And researchers think that cows are able to recognize between 50 and 70 herdmates, which means that in larger farms, it becomes more difficult for a cow to be in a group with more than 50-70 conspecifics. So it's better to have groups of maximum 70 individuals. So cattle live in groups, and within the group, they share positive relationships, which we can see through preferential positive interactions, such as allogrooming. They also synchronize their activities, and even more when they between a preferred partner, and they keep a special proximity also. In the group, there is also a dominant hierarchy between individuals, and this is done through dominance relationships. So here, for instance, we have the dominance relationship between A and B, which means that A, the Kohei, will have the priority for limited resources, which can be either food or, when it's very hot like today, shadow, for instance. And the subordinate will show avoidance reaction. All these relationships construct the dominance subordinate hierarchy inside the group, which is very different from leadership. And all these relationships are very stable over time. They are systematic, which means that when a group of cows gathered for the first time, there will be a lot of agonistic interaction in the first days, and then this number of negative interaction will decrease until the hierarchy is established. The patterns of such hierarchy are very variable. Here are some examples, very simple examples. So linear hierarchy, and there can be more different patterns with linear and triangle hierarchy. But it's not these photographs don't show all the hierarchy possible. It can be with different patterns. So the agonistic interaction we can encounter in the cows can be headbutts, fight, avoidance reaction, etc. So for instance, here on the picture we have the cow A that gives a headbutt to the cow B. This will induce either an avoidance reaction from the cow B, or this can lead to a fight, between A and B. And when the hierarchy is established, a threat, meaning no contact by co A, will induce submissive reaction by co B. Now we'll talk a little bit about maternal behavior. And as you know, domesticated co often leave the herd to calf. And the current research is addressing the question of the possibility to provide isolation at calving in barns. So here in this experiment, the author used two types of barn, one very classical and one where the walls were proposed in the corner to make it possible for the cows to isolate them from the herd. And what they saw is that in the uncovered pen, the cows calved in the same proportion in the corner or next to the window, while when the corner was partially covered, they preferred the corner. And also they spent more time in the corner around parturition. So they really seek seclusion to calve. And so the proposition is to add a secluded area to maternity pen to improve welfare. And there is also research that is assessing the same behavior in sick cows to see if sick cows prefer to isolate from the rest of the herd. After birth, there is a contact between the cow and the calf, which leads to bonding. These bonds are very long-lasting, and as you know, weaning is very stressful for the calves, and some researchers have found that early weaning is less stressful, early weaning being one day, versus longer weaning of 2 weeks. This is less stressful for the calf and the cow. In dairy farms, calves are raised in social isolation, and this leads to behavioral problems. They are more fearful afterwards. They are less dominant when mixed later in life. Such calves also have problems to cope with novelty, so they are more reactive to a starting stimuli, for instance. They develop more self-directed oral behavior, and they are more reactive to environmental and social novelty. It has also impacts on cognition with a lesser flexibility and a lesser learning capacities. So the current research is now assessing the possibility to raise calves in pairs in order to avoid such isolation, but also to take into account the health problem linked to mixing animals. Human-animal relationships with cattle. Such relationships are based on the history of regular interaction between the animal and the humans. And such interaction occur through observation, so only visual interaction, through movement of the animals, which implies visual, tactile, and auditory interactions, and also through situation during which the animals must be restrained, either for health or for management procedures. So such history of interaction and through the process of conditioning, the animals will associate humans to either rewarding or punishing events, and this will develop in cattle stimulus-specific responses, either positive or negative. Research has explored the age at which positive handling to the animals are most influential on human-animal relationships, and it was found that when the calves are very young, so at early age, and also just after weaning. These are kind of sensitive period, which the term sensitive period is not correct, but it provokes long-lasting impacts. However, subsequent human contact can modify the early learning effects. So the positive interactions are, as I told you before, talking gently, stroking, applied to a manner that is similar to intraspecific grooming. This was shown to decrease heart rates, and the animals were adopting relaxed body posture. And on the opposite, negative interaction are yelling, striking, using prods to move the animals, for instance. And in the dairy cow, it has been shown that the presence of a negative handler during milking induced a decrease in milk yield in the cow. Currently, the field of positive immersion in handling is still largely explored, and it can be further research. But I wanted to show you results from a research that was that can impact your practice. So, how does the cow perceive rectal palpation? So, in a study from colleague from Austria, they show that rectal palpation induces stress in dairy cows. The cows move more and their heart rate increase. And these authors showed that previous positive handling of the cow and positive and gentle interaction during the procedures reduced such stress reactions. So we can improve the welfare of the animals in such way. One question is often asked question is, does genetic selection have impacted behavior? And the research that addresses that question focused mainly on temperaments. Temperament is the animal's response to a challenging situation, and such response could be consistent over time. The temperaments traits that are mostly assessed are handling temperament and maternal aggressiveness, and it's interesting because handling temperament affects the risk of injury in the animal, in handlers or in other animals, and it also impacts the performances for meat production and milk production also. So regarding these variation in handling ease, it has been shown that both stories are more easy to handle than both indicus. That also there is some differences between both stories breeds, with Angus cattle being more easy to handle than Simmental. There was also milking temperament observed between dairy breeds, the Jersey cows being easier to milk than Ayrshire and Holstein cows. But in a recent research about responses of Holstein cows and Montbéliard cows, we didn't see any difference between the two breeds in avoidance distance tests. So it's the hypothesis between is more than it's more likely to be due than to differences in the way cattle are raised, and it is hypothesized that sire has a strong effect on the reactivity of the cows. So now we'll talk about biological rhythm and space. So basically, the time budget of the dairy cow is as follows. They rest and they lie during more or less half of the day. They spend 7 hours lying down and ruminating, and between 4 and 5 hours sleeping. And its sleep occurs in different bouts. They eat between 3 and 6 hours per day. They stand between 2 and 3 hours per day, and they drink for 30 minutes, more or less. And this time budget varies with production level, housing systems, facilities, and practices. And an important point is to remember that cattle synchronize their activity. So it's very important to give them the opportunity to rest at the same time in the barn. That means to have enough cubicle in the barn as the number of cows and the same number of eating places in the barn. They also change their time budgets according to the season. So this is a very old study, but very interesting though. So we can see eating, standing, and lying by the cows. And you can see that during summer, they eat during the early morning and late afternoon. During the day, they stand, and mostly between 7 a.m. and 5 p.m., and they lie down less during early morning and late afternoon because they are eating at this time. And what you can see is that during winter, they change a bit the way they organize the day. They eat more during daylight, and they lie less during daylight. Another question that is often asked is, are cattle motivated to graze? So grazing combine locomotor behavior and feeding behavior, and research has shown that cows are highly motivated to walk. In indoor systems, the animals have many benefits, such as the protection from predators. They reduce their exposure to extreme weather conditions, and they have the feed that is provided throughout the year. The grazing is also has benefits for the animal, so they can perform natural behavior. Mm-hmm. It decreases the prevalence of lameness. It also reduces the incidence of other problems, and it increases cleanliness. So are the cattle motivated to graze? When they are provided free daytime access to pasture during the summer, they go out and remain at pasture. However, there are factors that changes such response. The climate is important, and also the previous experience of the cow with going outside. Previous experience during lactation and also during rearing. That means that a cow can have a neophobia to go outside if she was not used to go outside previously. And also the quality of pasture is very important for the motivation of the cow to go out. So actually, current research is addressing the importance for the cow to control the possibility to go out to pasture. A possibility for high-producing dairy cows is to provide silage on pastures in addition to good pastures management to allow them to meet energy and nutrition requirements and also welfare. In our group, there is research currently on the activities of the cow, and we use a system called CowView, which is a real-time localization system in the barn. So each cow has a tag, and there are antenna in the barn, and so we know exactly where the cow is, if she is either in the cubicles, in the alley, or at the feeding place. And based on such information, we can calculate activity level of the animals. So here you have the activity level on the 24 hours of the day, and you can see that the cows are more active between 8 a.m. and 10 p.m. And there is two peaks of activity around 10 a.m. and 5 p.m. The interesting finding here is that such activity changes with the health status of the cow. When the cows have mastitis, they are more active during the day. And when they are lame, they are less active during the day, they are more active during the night, and the daily variation are less marked. And the very interesting finding here is that such signals were more precocial than detection of the health problem by the farmer. So this can be used as alarm signal. So this technology, precision livestock farming technology, can be used for new practice of welfare and health management in dairy cattle. Now I will talk a bit about space and ergonomy, and it's really important when we design barns to take into account the animal dimensions, their postures. Here it's an example of the lying posture in dairy cows, and also of the movement. A movie to show you how the cow uses her head to raise up as a balance. So it's very important to take this into account when designing barns. And you know that in many barns there is no enough space to allow the cow to perform such movement. And this can lead to behavioral problems. So as here, for instance, you can see that the space in front of the cows makes it difficult for her to stand up and lie down. This is a barn that was visited by my colleague Luc Mounier, and you can see that the heifers were not motivated at all to go lie in the cubicles, and so they lay in the corridor. So these were heifers, but for dairy cattle this can lead to health problems, and especially mastitis. And here, this is a farm I visited during my PhD. It was a very old farm, building in the 80s, and the cows have grown up, are taller than in the 80s, and you can see that the cubicles were too small for the cow, and this cow had such behavior which is totally not normal. So I will end my talk with very tiny aspects of welfare assessments, just to explain that the improvements of animal welfare on farms relies on four main steps. First, to assess culture, to identify the impaired aspects, then to identify the risk indicators and the risk factors, to propose corrections on these risk factors. And the implementation of correction can be made only by the cooperation between the veterinarian, the farmer, and the stakeholder. The welfare assessment needs tools to assess animal welfare. These ones are available for welfare assessment protocol, which have been developed through two main projects. So you can see that a wide range of species can have welfare assessment protocols, among them dairy cows. And I will leave the rest of the talk to Christophe, who will present you more information about how to assess animal welfare on farms. Thank you very much for your attention.